Supposed to be silver linings and happy endings to most fairy tales, but for one man, his story has turned into a nightmare. In 1976, Mark Fidrych was sitting on top of the world. Now he's just trying to hold on to what's left of his dream. Lee Majors takes us into the operating room where a frightening new technology could create a generation of computerized athletes. And we'll take a lighthearted look at some of the most bizarre football plays of the past decade with O.J. Simpson. All on America's Heroes.
That may be our most human quality. In athletes, it's sometimes the most noble pursuit. It can also be the saddest, like a Don Quixote tilting at windmills. Either way, it truly embodies the spirit of man. In 1976, America was celebrating its 200th birthday with fireworks and tall ships.
And in Detroit, a fairy tale was beginning to unfold. The explosions of the bicentennial gave way to a firecracker who took a depressed city by storm. Joe Falls, popular sports editor of the Detroit News, remembers.
This is how it all began, smoothing out the dirt and patting the mound. You see this? That's a baseball. That's an American League baseball. You know what he used to do to it? He used to talk to it. Come on, ball. Stay low, ball. Stay low. Stay low, ball. This happened back in 1976, which seems like an awfully long time ago now, but it was on this pitching mound in the middle of Tiger Stadium in the city of Detroit that a young man named Mark Fidrych captured the imagination of the city. I saw it happen, but I still don't believe it, because it was kind of a joyful madness. The White Sox had come in on a Tuesday night, 8,000 people. Wednesday night, the White Sox again, 45,000 people. You know, I've written sports in this town for a long time, but I've never seen an athlete quite like Mark Fidrych.
76 marked the first year of budget crisis in the city, layoffs, etc. Mark Fidrych became a rallying point.
And rally the city he did. They showed him so much love that they wouldn't let him leave the ballpark, and he responded with baseball's first version of the curtain call. The cheers made him want to give the fans more, and he had his chance on a July night in 1976 when he became only the second rookie ever to start an All-Star game. One of the game's greatest hitters remembers the bird.
He had a very good slider. He threw a changeup on occasion, but he mostly was a hard pitcher. Hard fastball, hard slider, kept everything down with very good control. He was an outstanding competitor. He came at you at all times. When the count was 2 balls and no strikes, 2-1 or 3-1, he did not dilly-dally around. He challenged you.
He was becoming a great pitcher, but it was his routine that captured the headlines. The way he talked to the mound, the way he talked to the ball, the way he talked to himself. He became the talk of the nation, both on the field and off. Joe Falls was there.
This is where Mark Fidrych lived. And let me tell you, this was the Detroit Zoo right here. Pictures, signs, banners, bags of mail. Every night, now get this, 10 birthday cakes would come in from the fans. I don't know where they came from or who ate them, but there'd be 10 birthday cakes around here. And when I'd come in to talk to Mark Fidrych, I always felt like I was in the middle of a Fellini movie. It was absolute madness.
Then on a Monday night, in front of a national television audience, Mark Fidrych captured the hearts of the entire country. Warner Wolf called the action.
And the Tigers act like Fidrych has just won the seventh game of the World Series.
He has.
So Mark Fidrych, thanking his teammates. Look at that. He's thanking his teammates. He's thanking the umpires, everybody, the ground crew. And the fans want him to come back.
He finished the year with a 19-9 record, and everything seemed like a fairy tale. But then Mark Fidrych hurt his knee in spring training, and the slide to obscurity began. They operated on his knee, and he became but a line in the baseball record book. He began hitting the whistle stops, Lakeland, Evansville. And now the story takes us to a little ballpark in Pawtucket, Rhode Island, where he's still trying to make it back in the Red Sox farm system.
Well, the way I look at it is basically the more years I've been putting in, the better it's been getting. Where before I was down in the bottomless pit where I couldn't pitch, couldn't even throw, couldn't even pick up my arm. Now I'm back throwing again, and then I can throw on the sidelines, and every 5 days I'm back out there when I was starting. Up until this year, I'm going to be a reliever. But basically, I've been able to do all this over again, and now it's getting to rewarding time And to me, that is what's keeping me going. Now, when I step out on the mound, where before it was, oh my God, what's going to happen today? Now I step out there and say, hey, I can make things happen. And that right there gave me the positive mind again of challenging people. Now I go back out there, I can throw four fastballs at a hitter and not think about it. I'm basically on a minor league contract. It's a lot different. I only get paid until September. And last year I made $18,000. To me, it's not the money. It's still being able to play the game. Someday, when I get back up to the big leagues, that's when I'll start making the big league money again.
The last game he pitched in spring training was against the Mets, and he threw the ball with more velocity than any time I'd seen him since he hurt his arm, but he was very wild. And when he left the National League, I talked to him when he went back to Pawtucket, and I said, Mark, if you keep that velocity now and get your control back, you're going to surprise an awful lot of people. And I certainly hope he does, because he'd be a great asset not only to our ball club, but to all baseball.
Like Gates Brown told me, he says, you know, you've seen everything now. You've seen the high as you can get, you know, 119 games. You've seen the bottomless pit. Now you're in the middle, you're back in the minors again where you probably never thought you'd be there. So I think baseball has been very interesting to me, where I've seen it all. I mean, it's not like some guys just see the high, I've never seen the lows. Well, I've seen it all.
Plugging, and I look forward to seeing you back in the big leagues, smoothing out the dirt, talking to the ball, shaking hands, jumping up and down, getting hitters out.
To Mark Fidrych, Detroit misses you, and we're still behind you all the way. We're to the bird. Fidrych. Maybe he'll make it back to the major leagues, maybe he won't. But maybe the most important thing is that he's still trying.
If Mark ever does make it back into the big leagues, he'll find a pot of gold he could have never dreamed of in 1976.
20 years ago, baseball's top players deserved top salaries. Here are the highest paid players at each position for 1963. At first base, Moose Gallen of the Yankees, $45,000. At second, the Yanks, Bobby Richardson at $50,000. And playing short, another Yankee, Tony Kubek. The Yanks didn't do too badly even before George. The highest paid third baseman from the Milwaukee Braves, Eddie Matthews. And behind the plate, Yogi Berra at $75,000. In left field, the incomparable Willie Mays at $120,000. In center, the Commerce Comet, Mickey Mantle, $125,000. And in right, home run king Roger Maris at $75,000. The top right-hander in 63 was Detroit's Jim Bunning, and the highest paid southpaw was Whitey Ford. And coming in from the bullpen, as always, was Hoyt Wilhelm at $30,000. Total, the entire team made $742,000, which by comparison to today's salary, are you ready for this? Doesn't equal the paycheck of California Angel second baseman Bobby Grich, who earns over $800,000.
And comparing the entire team of leading money makers in 1963 to today's stars, the difference is a paltry $742,000 in 63 to over $16 million in 1983. If the salaries were to grow at the same rate, by the year 2003, the top paid players in these positions would earn a total of almost $370 million, which is more than the entire gross national product of Gambia.
Sports medicine suffered another setback yesterday when a team of surgeons was again unsuccessful in trying to control fight promoter Don King's hair. King confided to doctors that part of the problem may lie in the fact he's been blow-drying his hair with a 747.
Coming up, four-time Olympic gold medalist